So welcome to the Demography Today lecture series, sponsored by the BBVA Foundation and in coordination with the Horizon 2020 LOMPOP project. We have the pleasure to have here today Virgilio Gomez Rubio. Is an associate professor at the Department of Mathematics at the University of Castilla-La Mancha in Spain. He has been, before joining the Castilla-La Mancha University, he has been research associate at the Department of Epidemiology and Biostatistics at the Imperial College London, UK. He has been working with R, and he is one of the key experts on R in Spain. He has developed quite a number of R software packages, especially in data analysis and Bayesian inference. He is co-author of one of the best sellers of Springer's series, Applied Spatial Data Analysis with R, and he has been teaching on spatial analysis and R for quite a while. He is now mostly focused on Bayesian inference, spatial statistics, and computational statistics. He is leading a project on the analysis of multivariate data for disease mapping to develop novel models, computational tools, and software for Bayesian inference of spatiotemporal models. And he is also involved in the project with the Babar Research Group at the University of Valencia on the analysis of highly correlated data, where he's developing models for the analysis of spatiotemporal data. So thank you very much, Virgilio, for accepting to be here for this training course. This training course, it will be 10 hours. We will have 5 hours today and 5 hours tomorrow from 9 to 3. There will be half of the time, it will be just for a kind of theoretical lecture, and then we will have practice. And we will have a break around 10:30 and half an hour break, and then we will carry on until 3. So welcome, and the floor is yours.
Thank you. Thank you. Just a few things before we start. I think that the main reason why you are doing this on Facebook, this is something that we wrote this together with Doyen Paranet and Professor. They have also developed some of the teaching materials that I will be using today, but this is the book that we wrote, and it's a quite nice introduction to the analysis of spatial data with R. In our sentence, we also had the pleasure to organize a few years ago with the user meeting. This is the national meeting sponsored by the R Foundation. And so we developed this logo here. This is our Don Quixote and R using like posing as a windmill. So I brought you some pins and stickers with the logo, so you can stick one here. Okay. So they told me that the course materials that I will be using are in that address. You can also find them in my website. I put a link. So if you just Google my name, and then you will find my webpage. So there is a link to the materials there, and so you can download them from there. So we will be together in hours, I hope. So in the materials you will find a few things. This in the main folder you will find this mixture of PDF files and R files. I will be sort of teaching like 4 lectures of 1 hour and a half each. So this is going to give the theory, and then after each lecture we will have roughly 1 hour practice. So this is for the lectures. So you will have a PDF, and then you will have some associated R files so that you can reproduce all the computational results in the slides can be reproduced. You have a number of folders here. So data sets is where I put some of the data sets all the data sets, and I think a few more that we will be using it for the lectures. Then you have a folder with results. These are the set results that I computed, because some of them take a while, so I just put them here. This is some other code that we will be using, but this is not really, you don't need to check this. And then in the practical folder is where all the practicals are. So you can just open it, and then you will find a similar thing. You have For practical here, with associated R files, I think it should be an R file for this one. And this is something that these are some scripts that that you will be following in the practical. So the practicals are for you to run, I mean, to go check these scripts and files and go through all the exercises and examples. And then if you have any questions, you can ask them. Right? So I will be teaching the lecture theater, but the practicals are for you. So I will probably not be running the code, but if, but as I said, you have all the code there. I will just show you when we start with the example, with the code, how to run it, and how I expect you to follow the lectures that are. So we will have four lectures. The first one is about an introduction to spatial data with R. So it's about data classes, visualization, and data import and export. So I've been told that some of you may already be familiar with this, and some others may not, but it's just an introduction to all these topics. The second lecture will be about the spatial autocorrelation, which I think it's the beginning for any spatial analysis. When we want to conduct a spatial analysis, we want to make sure that the data has some sort of spatial structure. So testing for a spatial autocorrelation or a spatial association between two variables, I think that's something important. And the third one will be about the spatial econometrics, and the last one will be about the SIS mapping. So I will be focusing on a very particular type of data, which is lattice data. Here I will mention point patterns and geostatistics, because I think these are the three main fields of spatial statistics, like lattice data, geostatistics, and point patterns. But just in this course, I will be just focusing on the analysis of lattice data and regression models for And as I mentioned before, most of these slides, well, have been developed by Roger Vivan, and some of the examples have also been developed together with Elsa Pavesma, and there are some bits here from our book, but I think most of the slides that I will be showing in this lecture and the next one have been developed by Roger, and I just modified some of the examples, and I added a few more things. So I think that, are you all familiar with R? I guess. Okay. So I don't think I need to explain why we may want to use R. Very quickly, R is like, right now it's it's like a standard language, maybe together with Python for statistical data analysis, in particular in the academia and some big companies like Facebook or Google or Microsoft, they are using R a lot for data analysis as well. So I think R is really the tool that you want to learn if you want to do statistical analysis. The nice thing about R is that there is a large community around it, so it means that there is a lot of code around there. So just if you have any questions, probably you can ask at the mailing list and you will get a very quick answer, and probably you can also find examples of what you want to do with your data, because someone else may have just done it and posted something. In terms of spatial analysis, there are many tools right now. My feeling is that most of them are for data handling and data visualization, but there are also a number of tools that we can use for proper statistical analysis, or not just visualization and descriptive analysis, but like regression model tests and so on. And the nice thing is that the R can really help you to answer non-standard recent questions, which is why I think that we... So just a few examples where we find these special problems. For example, in geography, we may be interested on how settlements, ancient settlements, are located, and because they may be related to the location of natural resources, mountains, rivers, and so on. So there may be some sort of spatial dependence between the locations and the access to natural resources. In econometrics, a typical question these days is what flat rocks density in the city. So this is, we may have the city divided into different neighborhoods, so we want to study the average or the median flat price in these neighborhoods and then do a map of using some of these. In ecology, a typical question is how different species of trees are distributed in the forest. So we may be interested in studying just a single species, or we may be interested in studying different species to see if there is sort of competition or any other kind of relationship. In epidemiology, which is where I have done most of my work, we may be interested in mapping risk. So we may have the number of cases, the population, and then we may want to map the risk or whether we have more cases than expected in certain administrative regions, or whether risk is linked to some sort of the presence of some pollution sources and other risk factors. In environmetrics, this is also a very typical example. We may be interested in predicting the or estimating the concentration of a pollutant from the samples obtained from a set of measuring stations. So it could be also applied to temperature or any type of continuous variable in the space. And finally, yes, in public policy, something that we often see in the news is, for example, about employment, where is unemployment higher, or we may be interested in identifying areas with a high rate of unemployment or low income, so that if we need to benefit or from certain policies or funds, we need to identify or provide indicators for these regions so that they can be used in these are different types of special data, and the thing is, these questions are different, but some of the tools are similar. So some of the tools that we may need to may use to answer these questions are quite similar. And that's a good idea. So in R we have a number of passages that we can use to tackle these problems. There are a number of packages in R that we can actually use for analyzing all these type of data that I mentioned. And I have made a very short summary here. So we are interested in point patterns. Point patterns, for example, the study of the location of trees in a forest where we have the locations of the events, like the trees. So we have this practice here. Probably Spatterstat is the one that has been leading the reason for the answer for budget. This is a very comprehensive package. Then if we use statistics, we have a number of packages. The ones that I use probably are GSTAT and UR, but I mean there are a few others. For the analysis of lattice and area data, this is the focus of this course, so we will be actually focusing on the analysis of this type of data. We can use, these are a few of them, but the thing is the analysis of lattice data also can also benefit from certain modeling tools such as additive models or packages for Bayesian inference, where we can build regression models where we have fixed effects, essentially variate, plus some other complex effects such as random effects with respect to structure. But this is what I will be mentioning. So essentially, I will be focusing on this type of data, and the tools that we will be using are essentially, well, some of the functions in the SPDF package, plus some other functions that are just built. Just to show you or to give you a glimpse of what R can do. So this is an example that Roger prepared based on the. This is a classic example, and this is from a cholera outbreak in the 19th century in London. It was analyzed by John Snow. So John Snow is sometimes then as the father of modern epidemiology or species epidemiology, because he was a medical doctor in London, and he was studying a cholera outbreak in the Soho district. So you have been to London, that Soho is in the center. So he had already a working hypothesis that it could be this outbreak or this epidemic could be caused by something in the water. And he made a study. One of the things that he provided after his study was this map. So this is one of the first disease maps that we can find. And I think that the outbreak was caused by an infected plant. the families are around here. So he was counting the number of cases in this Soho district. And well, he had already had a working hypothesis based on some other information, but one of the things is he provided with this map, but he decided to close this pan, and then after he closed, he then removed the handle. So after that, the cholera outbreak just disappeared. And so this is the map that he produced in the 19th century. So this is something that we could do with R, for example. This is the code that we would be using with R and the graphs are GIS. So this is, but essentially, if you want to do something with R, you are not supposed to install. This is just an example of, to show you how simple this can be. And so essentially, this is what something that we can provide with R. And so this is the location of the infected pump. And then all these asterisks show some other pumps. So we had a number of bubbles here, The bubbles show the number of cases, and if they are in gray, it means that these cases are closer to the infected pump. If they are in this pinky color, it means that these cases are closer to any other of the pumps which were not infected. Right? So, and also you can see in the background, so this gradient here, so this is a measure of the distance of to the infected pump. So you can see that most of the cases are closer to the infected pump. So if we wanted to do a spatial analysis, or Jonas not wanted to do spatial analysis, this is the sort of pump that he could produce these days with R and some other tools for spatial analysis. So this is, I think, this is a very nice example, and as I said, this is mostly developed by Roger Vivaldo, by creating collective data, put them in the right format, and then it's very nice. So you can see this was like the 19th century, this is nowadays, so I think it's nice. Okay. So this first lecture will be about loading data and visualizing data in R. Most of the things that I'm going to mention are based on this paper by Roger Duban and Sandra Desma in our book. So essentially in the book we have a description of how this tools or these classes or objects or data types for spatial data work, plus how we can use them for the spatial data analysis. So the book is split into two parts. The first one is about handling, visualizing, and loading data, and the second part is about analyzing. But essentially, they develop a number of data types or classes or objects in R to handle and store spatial data, and that's what we the basis of this lecture. I will be focusing on the ESP package. Right now, Redmap is developing another package, which is called the SF package, which is based on introducing simple features in, I think it's a standard in geocomputation, to represent spatial data. So I think that shortly we will be moving from the ESP package to the SF package. The SF package is currently under development. So I prefer to include some examples in the first practical, which is about disease mapping. So in the fourth practical, you will see some examples of how the SF package work. But essentially, all the things that I will mention here about data types, and also the way we apply to the SF package, because the data types are very, very similar. Although the SF package is, I think it's more comprehensive in the sense that it really integrates very well like data types in R and importing from different sources. So, I mean, if you're interested, we can talk about that. I will be focusing on what we wrote in this book for the data types, for the analysis of spatial data or graphics data. Then, if you have questions, there is this RCGeo mailing list, where you can actually find more information, or you can actually, if you have questions, you can actually post questions about these boxes here. There is also, I don't think many people know about this, but there are in R what they call the task views, and they are on CRAN. Just let me show you. they have something which is called task views here. So this is an annotated list of packages on many different topics. So there are actually two sections, one on spatial data and the other one on spatial temporal data. So there, if you click on the spatial task view here, you will find that this is this maintained by Roger Vance, and here you will find a description of the main packages for spatial data, and well, they are organized into different groups depending, for example, this is classes for spatial data, and this is a package for handling spatial data, and I think that there are some other for reading and writing spatial data. So I think there are associations. So you can, if you are looking for a special package to do something specific, this is probably the best way to start. And of course there is another one on space time data, but I will not discuss that. But if you are interested in modeling special data, special temporal data, then you can so now I will be discussing the different types of data that we find in spatial statistics, although in later lectures I will just focus on this and that data. So we focusing on three examples. For example, we may start with point patterns. So in the analysis of point patterns, we study the location of certain types of events. So in this example, what I show is that this example is about the location of the starting point of tornadoes in the US in 2009. This is a data set that I will show you now. So essentially, here we have the map of the United States, and we have recorded the starting point of the tornado. So we want to study where tornadoes appear more often. We have a particular state where we find the higher number of tornadoes. In geostatistics, the typical problem is the estimation of a pollutant or some other variable in a continuous space. So in this case, a typical example that it's from a classic data set is the study of the distribution of heavy metals around the Meuse River, which is in Belgium and the Netherlands. So in this case, what happens is that the river is very polluted, it has a high concentration of heavy metals, so every time there is heavy rain, the river gets into the nearby fields, so the heavy metals move from the water to the nearby fields, and we may be interested in estimating the concentration of different types of heavy metal, like zinc, cadmium, and others, in the field. So we may collect a study where we pick some locations, and then we collect samples from the soil, we measure the concentration of heavy metals, and from these measurements we want to get an estimate of the concentration of heavy metal at the in every point of the, this is another example. And finally, for the analysis of that data, this is usually the analysis of data that we obtain at different administrative levels. So in this case, for example, we may be interested in estimating the case of sudden infant death syndrome in North Carolina. This is also a classic data set in this mapping. So essentially what we have here are the counties in North Carolina, I think there are 100 of them. We have the number of cases of this disease. We have the number of newborn children. And then we have some other variables like the ethnic distribution of the population and some of the socioeconomic factors that may be related to this, to the risk of suffering from this syndrome. So essentially, here we have points that show the location of the events as we study. Here we have some locations where we sample some variables of interest and from which we want to estimate the value of this variable at any point of the study period. And here we have some administrative data at different administrative levels, and then we want to study. So essentially we have three different types of data, and so essentially when we have a point pattern, we have the coordinates of the points and possibly boundary of the study region. So in this case, we would have the starting point of the tornadoes, and the boundary is the boundary of the outer boundary of the contiguous states in the US. We may also have sometimes a data frame, a matrix in there with the information about the tornado, for example, the state where it started, the date, the time, the EF scale, which is the strength, and I think it goes from 0 to 5, 0 is a very mild tornado, and 5 is a very strong tornado, the economic loss that is sometimes measured, and so on. And so this is the, if we are trying to do a point pattern analysis, this is the sort of data that we have in geostatistics. We also have the coordinates of sampling points, and we would have the location of the concentration of heavy metals at those points, on which I will interpolate or extrapolate to the other points. Okay? And we may have some other data describing the type of terrain, but so essentially we may have, for example, the altitude in the study area, and these values would be provided for any point in the study region. So in practice, we would have this information available in a grid. The standard regions have an infinite number of points. We need a discrete representation of that, and for that we have grids. So that's the type of data that we need. And finally, for that data, we will have the boundaries, the administrative boundaries for each area of study. And then, attached to each boundary or to each region, we will have a number of variables, like population, like income, the number of cases, the number of cases. So essentially, different types of spatial problems require different types of data, and so I will be showing you this different types of data. As I mentioned before, the analysis will be focusing on this type of data in the okay. So what the type of analysis that is required is different depending on the problem. So for point patterns, we want to get an estimate of the intensity. So in this case, the spatial distribution of tornadoes. So the intensity essentially is like a surface which has peaks where we have a high incidence of tornadoes and valleys where we have a low incidence. So it's a continuous surface, and it used to represent the spatial distribution. In geostatistics, what we want to do is to get also a surface but with the estimated value of the concentration of a given heavy metal in the area, and you probably heard about green or interpolation, but this is something that is one tool that I use in statistics. And for the analysis of lattice data, we want to get estimates of some parameter of interest. It could be like the risk or income or the number of people in poverty, whatever. So, but then we want to get estimates at the different administrative levels. And these models are, or this analysis, mostly based on progression models, which could be linear models, generalized linear models. If, for example, we have two model counts, we can use a generalized linear model. If we want to include a spatial structure in the model, we may have generalized linear mixed models, where we have fixed effects based on covariates plus some other effects, random effects, which model spatial dependence. And then we can have additive models and some other models. So essentially, different types of problems required in the data. Okay. So I will be going very quickly through all these different data types, but really for the real analysis, I will be focusing on that. So essentially, in order to be able to handle this data in R, we need a data representation, a data structure that will represent this. This is often called an object. So an object is essentially a way to represent this, and also a way to include functions to work with this data. For example, if I have points, in this case, if I have a point pattern, the internal representation may be a matrix with two columns, so that the first row are the coordinates of the first tornado, and so on. And this will be stored in R, and then I may want to write a function to get the coordinates of this tornado. So that would be a function and associated to that object. So essentially an object is a way of putting together the data that we want, the spatial data, plus some other functions to work with this. Okay. So there are different types of objects in R. I will not really go into that, but the classes, the objects that I'm going to show you now are new style classes, which is often called S4. There is another type of classes are ES3, which are simpler in design, but in this case the ESP package is based on this one, but it's too much. Okay. So essentially, they designed a very simple special object. So the simplest special object that you can have is, which is for the special class, is essentially a bounding box of your study area, and then a CRS, with, this is a coordinate reference system. So essentially, the simplest special object, which actually has no data, is this special data type. And all the other data types will be derived from this one. So essentially, this just has the bounding box of the study region and the coordinate reference system. Okay, I will be mentioning this. And then all the other objects will be derived from this one. So the first one is this is called the special points object. So this is just a representation of a point pattern, a point pattern with no associated data. So essentially, this will have a bounding box with a study region, a coordinate reference system, and the coordinates of the point. So this is the simplest spatial object with data. If we have an associated data frame with information about the tornadoes, then we will create a spatial point data, and we will have the same for lines and polygons that I will be showing you later. So essentially, in the spatial points we have the values of the points for the inputs of the tornadoes, the bounding box and the coordinate reference system, and if we have, for example, 1,000 points here, in the special point data frame we will have in addition a data frame with 1,000 rows representing the additional information for you. So I'm just going to move to the first actual example. So the first example is about going data, and then it's about this tornado data. So these data were obtained from the Storm Prediction Center, where they record the tornadoes since the early 50s. And then they essentially provide the location of the tornadoes and some other information, like the scale and other information. So I took this picture. This is from the Wizard of Oz. So one of the things that I noticed when I started to use this data is that actually Kansas, which is where the movie starts, is probably the state with highest number of tornadoes in the area. I think Texas is the one with the highest number of tornadoes, but it's also, I think the area is also larger in Texas, but then Kansas is a smaller state with really a very high number of tornadoes. So this story is very well placed because Kansas is really the place where you will find it. So I will not be covering any data analysis of point pattern, but it's really interesting. So this is just to show you how we would create or we will import this data in R. So in the datasets file, you have this CSV file with the information about the tornadoes. So we can use the function read.csv. To get this into a data frame. Then these are the names for the different columns in the data set. I took these names from the report where they describe this data set. So because the CSV file doesn't have the header, so I just have to provide the column names myself. But these are really very well documented. So this will give me a data frame with a 20 something columns, but if you look more closely, there is this slot and a slot. So this is the starting latitude and the starting longitude of the tornado. So this is just the data frame. But if I want to create a special object, I will be using these special points here with the coordinates. And then this prod string, this is essentially a way of indicating the coordinate reference system of this data. So this is longitude and latitude. So this is important because sometimes when we are putting different types of data together, you need to reproject. So you have like you may have satellite data, administrative data. When you want to put them together, you need to put them in the same units. So this is for that you need a coordinate reference system. And I always mention, I don't think it's I need to mention this here because you are in most of you are recording spatial data with spatial data, and we are in a cartographic institute. But this always reminds me of this case of this rocket launched by the European Space Agency that is they had to explode in the middle of its course, because apparently the software was designed by a British team and the European team, and someone, the British were using miles, the European were using kilometers, so they couldn't communicate, so they was a complete disaster. So this is essentially why we want to know the coordinate differences. Most in my work, for example, usually I don't care about this because I work with administrative data, and in my case I don't need it. But if you want to use like different sources of data, you probably need to have this in mind, because otherwise you may be trying to plot like spatial data in different scales or different units, so it's so the nice thing about the spatial points is the following. I will show you an example with this. If I want to make a plot, I want, for example, R to take care of the axis. So if you have ever plot points in R, you will know that the axes are essentially different scales, or R doesn't know about the scale of the axis, so they will make them in the same length. So, but in a map, maybe if I, for example, plotting the US map, I want the x-axis to be wider than the y-axis, and some other stuff. But at the same time, if I want to get information about the tornadoes, for example, I want this to be behave as a data frame, because I'm just interested in, for example, the number of fatalities, so I may want to make a histogram of this, so I want this to behave also as a data frame when I want to access the code. So essentially, these spatial objects provide that. If I want to make a plot, they will be still plot, in the sense that I don't need to worry about the scale, the legends, and so on. But if I want to do a progression analysis, then they will behave as a data frame. Okay, so this is quite interesting. So with this, I was creating the spatial point object. There is no information attached to the tornado scheme. This will come in the next slide. But I can do a summary of it, and then this is what I get. This is the bounding box. This is just to make sure that this is not really data. This is the coordinate reference system. All these are based on the LeapPro library, so you probably are familiar with this. And then this is the number of points. So it means that in this data frame that I read, I had like 1,182. And if I want to make a special point data frame, which is the location of the tornadoes plus the data frame with the information, I can do something else. Okay. In the practicals, then you will see a different way of creating this, but this is just the special point that I have plus the data frame with all the data, so I put them together like this with all these functions, which are the data frame. And now if I look for the names of this, you will see that I have all this information here. So essentially, I can get a summary of the fatalities, or I can get a table of the month of the tornado. So you will see, if you want to visit the US, June probably this month is not very good because we have the peak of tornadoes. So don't go to Kansas in June. Okay. Or you will find lots of tornadoes. So I'm just going to run this very quickly just to show you what I meant about having these objects. Okay. So I don't know if you use RStudio, I'm not very proud of that. So this is the first part is in lecture 1A.R. So you will see that if you type lecture 1, so there is lecture 1.R, but that's identified. But then you can find lecture 1A, which is the part about the introduction to special classes. So this is what I meant. So this is the code that you have in the slides, in the previous slide. So this is the code that you can see in this slide is the one that you can see here. Okay. So this way you can actually run the code and reproduce all the results. So in the folder datasets you have these CSV files I mentioned before. So with this function I load it, and then with these special points I create the special point. Okay. And with this one here, in chunk number 2, I can create the spatial points data. So I'm going to run this just to show you why, because this is a very simple data set. In the data frame we have the points for the Torres, so why not just keeping with this data? So I'm going to show you why. And then in the following slides you talk to me if you want. So I'm just going to run this. Right. The first one. Yeah, I need to load the back. Okay, so this is what we have. So what I mentioned is that I already have the coordinates of the domain here in this data frame that I created. It was a slat and a slot. I'm just going to plot that. Okay, so this is slat. So these are from the data frame. Okay, so these are from the data frame. Well, this is what I mentioned. This is the continuous network space. I think there were some tornadoes in Hawaii and Puerto Rico, but essentially this is a bit of a mess in the sense that the scales do not make sense. If I plot the spatial objects that I created before, you will not do the same. So this. We need more information in the background probably, but you can see, well, this is probably the US, Puerto Rico, and some other US territories obviously. So this is from the spatial object. So you can see that somehow I took care of the scales of the axis. And this is like in the ring shape and so on. So this is one of the things that this spatial object will do for you. They will know that they are spatial objects and they will know how to produce them. So in this case, it's just for the axis and the location of the point. If we work with lattice data, they will these objects know that they will need to be filled. The image will need to be filled with colors according to autovariate, and the proper lane will be displayed. Okay, but so this is great. So now I can just add the data frame to the data using the code that I mentioned before. Here. I already mentioned this is in the second chunk. If I do a summary of this, we will have to do this. So if I go back, so if I do a summary of the spatial points data frame, this is the same information that I have from the spatial points plus the coordinates that I have. Okay, so I can actually go and select this column, for example, the month that I was showing you before. And do a statistical analysis of the month or the day of the month before. And also we can, for example, the state. So we can actually, you can see, actually this is Texas. We had 132 tornadoes, and this is Kansas with 103. Kansas is smaller than Texas. But essentially, just going back to the slides. Essentially, these spatial objects will handle the spatial information better, in particular for visualization. And that's something that is really part of these spatial objects, right? And well, essentially what happens is that when you call the plot function, there is a specific plot function for these spatial points, and that function will handle this. So this is a very simple representation of what we have. So we have, this is the spatial object that I mentioned before. This is just the bounded box and the coordinate inference system. So there is no actual data here. But then if we extend this and we add the coordinates, we have the spatial points. And then if we have a data frame, we will have these spatial points and data. Okay. So that's the answer. So it will be the same with lines and polygons. So we may have, instead of points, we may know the trajectories of the tornadoes, so instead of coordinates, we will have lines, and if we have administrative data, we will have points. Just one thing is that I wanted to mention is that usually, well, I think it depends, but usually you don't load the spatial data in this way, right? Because, for example, the Storm Prediction Center provides the same information in a shape file. So, for example, you can actually load the shape file just using a command, using the OGR library. You have raster data, you will be using GitHub. But then essentially they will create this special points or special lines or special polygons for you, so you don't need to go through all this stuff. Sometimes there is no other way. And actually what happened in this case is that I found out these CSV files first, so I did all the work to move them, and then some years later I found that the same information wasn't available in the same. So but this is, I think this is just an introduction of how you could actually create these data types. Using like simple commands, but most of the time it will, data will already be in a special format like OCIS, a file, GeoTIFF, but for that there are some specific functions that will produce the so in the same way that we have points, we may have lines. So there are some, so we will have this special lines object, which is just to represent lines, or special polygons, which are used to represent polygons. So the thing with lines and polygons that I'm going to skip is that these special lines have some smaller objects inside, which in this case are lines and line. So essentially a line is just a straight line. Okay? And then we have, this may represent just a segment of maybe a river. If we put some line together, we will have a lines object. So it's like, I may have like the representation of a rivet with different segments. So that would be a list of this object here, which will be like a line. And then the special line will be a collection of these ones. Right? And the same for polygons. We may have a region which is made of a small island. So each island will be represented using a boundary, a closed polygon. But the thing is that this collection of islands will have the same administrative ID. Okay, so we will have a polygon for each island, which together will be an object of type polygons, and then all together will be special polygons. Okay. But I just mentioned this, but essentially this is to represent lines without any extra information. A special polygon is to represent administrative area. So this will be the one that we will be using mostly in this course, because this is the one that we will be using for that data. And then if we have information associated to the lines or polygons, we will have a special lines data frame and a special polygon. So essentially, this could be used to represent the rivers in Spain. Maybe for each river, we have the length, the highest altitude or the starting point of the river, and so on. So we may have a lot of this. If we have administrative data, most of the time we will have this. This could be well represented, for example, municipalities in Spain, where we have population, number of cases of cancer, and so on. And as I said, this is the one that we use. As I said, most of the time we will not be creating these objects from scratch, but we will be loading them from a database. So this is an example. You can run it, but this is just to show you how we can create a special lines from scratch. So here, I will not explain this in detail, but we'll give you a rule idea of this. So essentially, because we have the starting and the ending point of the tornado, we can actually mimic or represent the trajectories of the tornadoes you survived. So in addition, I didn't mention this, but there is a number attached to the tornado, because sometimes what happens is that the tornado starts in one state, but then it crosses the border, and it goes into another state, but the idea of the tornado is the same, but it's recorded in different rows of the table. So what I have, what I do here very quickly, is that I take all these segments that represent the trajectory of the tornado and I put them together. So if the tornado started and ended in the same state, there is just a straight line. If it goes from one state to the other, you will have different straight lines. So that's what I'm doing here. And for this, I just create a special line object. So essentially here, I put all the segments together in a lines object. Then I put all these lines of it together. And that's it. But then, as I said, this is just in case you really want to do some geocomputation with your data. But this is what you get. So essentially, this points here, which are not really actually points, they are these straight lines, these are the trajectories of the tornadoes, and this boundary is here. This is a spatial polygon data frame, which is in this state, dh.rdata. So I already took these boundaries into a spatial polygon subject. I took these boundaries from the US Census Bureau, but for this course I just put everything together in another data so that it's easier to know. But this is essentially a spatial polygons data frame, where the boundaries are this, right here, and we have information about the state. I think it's the name, I think it's called the Phillips code, and some other information. So this is, with this dot function, I'm representing. With the first one, I just create this boundary, the boundary of the state, and then I would plot. These are the trajectories that I created before. So I'm just making a map with the trajectories and the states. You can see this is Kansas, so you can see, and this is Texas. So I mean, in the south of Kansas is where you can find really a high incidence of tornadoes. And Kansas, of course, has more tornadoes, but it also has a larger area. So I'd say that the state, the tornado state, is Kansas. And this is a very simple way of putting different spatial data together with this plot function. We will see different ways of using that in the practical. In the practical, after this lecture, you will find some other examples. And for example, you can use Google Maps in the background, or you can use, for example, it was possible to use OpenStreetMap in the background, but for some reason, I think that they cut this service. But then there are some other sources like Stamen that we can use very easily. That's something that I will see you later on in the talk. So this is another example. So there is the volcano dataset. The volcano dataset is essentially a matrix with where each pixel is representing the altitude of a volcano. I think it's in Hawaii. And so if the control lines function will give us a control line of that. But with this function, control lines to a spatial line in center frame, we can actually convert from this format to this spatial line in center frame. Okay. So this is an example, just functions that can convert from one format into another. So one of the problems, one of the main reasons to start developing these spatial objects is that, and I'm talking about 2003, which is, I think, 14 years ago. So in those days, and I'm starting to talk like a... So what happened is that they were not the unified data types for spatial data. Mm-hmm. So different packages would use different formats. But the problem is that if you took a spatial extraction from one package into another, sometimes it crashed. Some others you could get an answer, but the thing is that you were getting an answer from the wrong data, so there is no way to know that. So essentially, this spatial object try to provide a unified framework for spatial data. But if you have for example, in this case, a contour line, this is just a plot where you just get this contour line. But then you can, this is sort of spatial data, you can actually convert that into one of these spatial objects. So there is this for the contour line, but if you are working with point patterns, there are some other functions to convert, for example, from the format in sparse start into the format in the SP package. You may also be aware of the maps package. In the maps package provides maps in its own format, but there are also functions to convert these maps into a spatial polygons object, so that I think it's easy to go. Okay. So this is a summary of what I mentioned before. So this is the internal structure, and as I said, unless you really want to do some sort of fine geocomputation, most of the time it's just like calling a function to read the shape of these lines of polygons, and that's it. But this is not the sort of internal structure. So this is just about points, lines, and polygons. The other type of data that we saw, which appears, for example, in geostatistics, is about grids. And there are essentially two types of grids. which is called special pixel and special grid. The special grid is a regular grid, so a rectangular grid where we have the offset, the starting point, the weight. We have the cell size of the pixel, and then we have the number of cells in the x and y axis. So in this case, we don't need, because it's a regular grid, we don't need to store the points, the actual points of the grid, because we know that it's a grid, we know that it's a, you know, this orientation, and so then we can identify the observations. The space in the special pixels case, this is different because this, if we, for example, want to study just the US, if we cover it with a regular grid, some of the points will be on the OCM, so we wouldn't want to get those points in the grid. So we can cut the grid, but if we can remove points in a regular grid, then we need to store the actual location of the points, and that's for the special pixels. Right? So essentially, this is a regular grid where no point of the, no, the location of the points is not stored, but in the special pixels, we do. Okay, and I will show you an example. If we have information about the pixels, like the concentration of heavy metals or anything, we will have a special pixel data frame or special grid data. So this is, again, this is an example on how to create a grid. So essentially we have the range, the number of cells, okay, so this is the size of the cell in the x and y dimension, this is the range that we will be covered. And this is the number of cells. So this is just this is the range and I know the size. So this is just this is with this grid topology I define the center offset, right? The cell size and the number of cells in its direction. And then with this topology and the coordinate reference system using the special grid, I create this grid. If you have raster data and then you import it using like the GDAL library, you will get one of these special grid objects. So you don't need to do this. Yes. So this is the grid, and it's covering the US. But then I'm not. If I want to estimate the intensity of tornadoes, I don't want to get an estimate here because this is all the same. I just want to consider the continental area. So I really need to do an overlay and say, okay, if this pixel is not touching, or the center of this pixel is not inside the boundary of the US, then I want to remove it. So that's what we do with this. So this is actually the actual grid that I'm interested in, because if I need to predict, I want to predict in places where people live. So the over function essentially, it's a function to combine or to overimpose different layers in spatial data. So in this case, we have this is the grid that we created before. This is the boundary of the states in the US. So essentially this will, for each point of the grid, it will check to which state it depends. If it's not in any of the states, it will return an A. An A is the code or the value in R for missing values, which is, I think it's not available. So essentially if which point is inside the state, it will return the index for that state. If it's not, it will return an N. So essentially, here when I do, I get the coordinates of the grid. I remove all those with an NA index, and then I keep all the points in the grid. Okay, so as I said before, I'm not explaining this in detail, but I want you to give you an overall idea of what I'm doing here. So essentially, the over is a way of combining different layers of data, and then with these special pixels, I create a regular grid with some missing pixels here. So it cannot be a special grid because this is a special grid, right? I need to keep all the points for here. And this is just a simple representation of how grids are. So essentially we have a grid topology to define the starting point, cell size, and the number of cells in each direction. And then we have this grid topology, the special grid and the special pixels. If we have information about the points in the grid, we will have this special grid. And again, this is usually, if you have, for example, a geodiff, which I will show you an example later, there is just, you can get that into a special grid data frame using just one line. So you don't need to you don't need to do any of this. This is a summary of the different special classes provided in this package. So this is the data type, which could be points, full grid, line, or polygon. And then if it has attribute or not, and this is the class. So this is just if you need to load data or to create some special data from scratch, this is the next one. Something that I did not mention is that these objects will also behave as data frames. Well, I mentioned that. In terms of subsetting, so if I want to select a column, we have already seen that we can use the dollar, the column with the data, but I can also use this subset to reduce the number, for example, areas in a special polygon. So in the map of the US, if I want to select Kansas, just the boundaries of Kansas, I can do that by taking the whole object and then select the row where Kansas is. So I'll show you some examples later. But that's a very nice thing, because so I can get a whole data set, but then I want to reduce the special data according to a criterion. So I can use this subset to reduce the number of points or lines or polygons, depending on something. I can use the dollar, as I mentioned, to add new data, to access new data, or to change the data that I have. And then the bounding box is just to get the bounding box. So this is to get the coordinates of different systems. And this coordinate is to get the coordinates of the points or the centroids. Over is used to combine. And this chorus, which is here, but I often use the as function to convert from one object to the other. Okay, and the ESP sample is just to sample points inside the polygon or lines or behavior. So this is another way in which we can overlay the data. So if you recall, in the first flow that I showed you, we have this. So this is the total number of tornadoes collected by the storm prediction agency. But what happens is that I know if I'm only interested in this region here, I will just want to have this tornadoes here. So I want to remove all of this. So I can again use the over function using the location of the tornadoes and. So I can use the over function to check whether the tornadoes are in one of these states or not. So I can remove all the other tornadoes. So this is what is happening. With this over function, I get this index here. So if it's an A, it means that the tornadoes outside this region. So I remove it from the original dataset. So this is a special point data frame. So I'm just getting or giving the code which had an index which is not an A. So this is how I subset special information. Okay, I can have a variable or a different criterion here to choose whether I keep or not that special point, and that's what happened here. And this is the final product. So we can do, and there's an example later, we can do the same thing with polygons. Okay, and later I'll be showing how, for example, to select Kansas to plot it in a different polygon. Well, this is a summary of the benefits of different things, which are essentially that they will behave as a special object when I want to do a plot or a special analysis, and that they will behave as data frames when I want, for example, subset the special entities or the columns with data using the color. I think I was hoping to finish at half past 10, but I just tried to be faster. If you have any question, just raise your hand. So this is about visualization, and I'm going very quickly. We have already seen this. So essentially, there are two ways in which we can visualize this spatial information in one of these spatial objects. One is using the classic standard functions in alpha plotting. The other one is using the lattice, which I think is the nicer. But first of all, we will start with this. With the plot function. The plot function is the basic function when you plot in R. You are probably familiar with it. The thing is, in this case, this, although we write plot here, the internal function that is called when we use a special object is not the generic plot function, it's a specific plot function that is included in this package. Okay? So if you try to run this code, this is a way of converting the tornado data that we had into an object special. So the special is just a bounding box, and the coordinate is a different system. So if you run this line of code, you will get this box, but with an empty, it's just an empty box. Because this special object has actually no data. So again, the ask function is to convert from one object to another. So essentially, this ask special will remove the coordinates of the points and just get the bounding box. So this is useful when we want just to set the ranges of the static. If we run this, then we will get the points, right? And with this function here, what happens, you cannot see it here. So essentially, the first line just will close the box. The second line will add all the points, and the fourth line we just check which tornadoes have a strength of 4 and draw them in red. So you can see. So this, I think there are 4 of them. 1, 2. So these 2 points in red are tornadoes which have a strength of 4. So we are able to identify these. So here, essentially, this is the special point data frame. I select the rows with EF scale of 4, just using this condition here. And then, essentially here, I just remove all the other tornadoes with a strength which is of 4. So this is a way in which I can identify the particular points or lines or polygons so that I can keep them or and do whatever I want with them. In this case, I just call the plot function again, and this is in. We can do the same thing with polygons. For example, the states, the age, is a special polygons data frame. One of the columns is name, so I can actually, in Kansas, I can keep the boundary of Kansas. Why? Because I can actually use that to plot it in the different column. So here, I will get a plot of all the states, but with the zoom in this range, right? So this is just to the x limit and y limit, just to set the zoom in this region here, which is where Kansas is. And then with this, I get a subset Kansas again, and I put in this blueish color. So this is a very simple way using this standard plot function to put different data together. And this is the same as before, but overimposing the grid that I have. So essentially, this is where I get Kansas. Here I plot all the boundaries of the states. Here I plot Kansas in a different color. And here this plot, this is the grid, the special pixels data frame that I had before. So these are the pixels in there. So essentially, these are the pixels that I would be using for prediction, for example, for predicting the average number of tornadoes or any other. But essentially, with the plot function, just remember to add this add equal true here, because otherwise it will start a new plot. So essentially, this is a way in which you can get all these different types. So we can actually do a number of things with this. In this example, I use the over function with Kansas. So Kansas is the boundary of Kansas that I got before. So this object is just made of the boundary of Kansas. So with the over function, I can find the points in the grid which are actually inside Kansas, or with the center inside Kansas. So I can plot them in a different column. Okay, so this is just essentially a plot of the whole grid in using this point here. And then in red, I have plot the points in the side which are in Kansas, and then I add a label. This is a way in which I can produce different. This is the volcano data that I mentioned before. So the original data is a matrix, and each point of the matrix represents the altitude. And then here I was using the control line just to get the control line, which I can plot. with R, but then with this function I create a specialized data frame with when I have the lines and the altitude of each line, so that I can use the plot function again, but this is with a specialized data frame, and then I select the colors here. So the thing about this is that I want the special objects just to do this for me, or I want a function that will do this for me, like setting the different colors, setting the gradient, and so on. And that's something that we can use with a different with a different type of okay. I think I'm going to. I'm going to mention this very quickly. There is this package, the clustering package, which can be used to create different classes in the lab for us. For example, in this case, I can use the quantiles to get the different intervals for the logarithm of the economic loss. So the economic loss is inside this column here, loss. But the thing is that because most tornadoes do not produce any economic loss because they are very mild, and just a few tornadoes have very high economic losses, this is a very skewed variable. So I take the log of this variable, adding just a tiny amount here, and then if I want to put the logarithm of the loss, I want to get some sort of breaks for the legend. So I can, with this function here, I can get and five breaks using the quantiles. This is inside the class in the clustering package. So essentially, this is what I can. This is what I can. I can use this package just to provide reasonable breaks. So this is with the quantile criteria. There is another criteria which is deficit change that for breaks. And then what you can actually get different types of breaks here, and you can actually do it some data. So this is the cumulative probability function, which these are the different values here, and this is giving you the proportional values and the normal value. That's a way of representing the data from the break. So you will be using these breaks, or we will be using these breaks, for example, when representing the point. So these are the starting points of the tornado. So these are the breaks using the quantile. These are the breaks using the Fisher Jones criteria, and then you can see what the plots are similar. Okay. So, but again, I'm doing all this manually, and I would like to have something that do this for me, like plotting the data, coloring the data depending on the color, and then providing these legends. Okay, because in this case, I'm doing this myself with several lines. So in the SP packet there are a few functions to do this. So the first one is the bubble. With this the bubble function, this will provide a bubble plot. So here you can, this is just a call to a single function. As I said before, here we needed several functions to get this in different colors and then to get the lane and so on. So here what happens is that this is just a bubble plot. So I'm at the location of the tornadoes, I'm placing a bubble. Which is related to the economic loss. So the area of the bubble is related to the economic loss, and you can see a lot of tiny ones here with like three large dots here. So these are three tornadoes which had a very high strength and they caused high economic losses, right? So this is something that you can do with this bubble plot. So this bubble plot will take care of getting the axis right, plotting the bubbles with the right size in the right places, then it will have this title here, and it will also place the name here using appropriate sizes for the plots and this bubble here. So this is just with the bubble plot. So this is using not the standard graphics, but the some graphics included in the ESP package that are based on lattice. So this is one way. We will see more examples of using these lattice plots. This is another function which is called the ESP plot. So this is a generic function for plotting lines, points, and polygons. This is the one that we will be using most of the time for producing maps using administrative data. And there are some other options, but this is the one that we will be using. So here we have the special plotting data frame with the information about the tornado. This is the column that we want to plot. This is the logarithm of the economic loss. This is just the color that I want to use. I want to use, five groups, I have six colors here. But this is the different colors that I want to use. This is the number of cards that I want in my legend, so 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And then this script plot will put everything together to create this plot and get in a single plot function. So this is these are the functions that you probably want to use instead of the plot function, but if you still want to use the plot function, and then well, we can actually combine different layers using the script plot function. So I'm trying to finish. So I will probably take 10 more minutes, but I think I will finish in time. So we have seen the data types for spatial data, how to visualize spatial data. As I said, in the practical, you will go through examples of this point pattern geostatistics and large data, to show you how you can actually load and visualize the data. And this is the part which is about accessing spatial data. So I'm going to go straight to the point. So there are a number of functions to load mostly administrative data or lines or polygons in the map tools package. So if you want to read the shapefile, well, before that, I mentioned the maps library. So the maps library comes with a number of maps. And this is an example using this map to spatial polygons function, where you can actually use a map from this package and convert it into spatial polygons, so that you can actually use all these functions to plot your data. Or if you have administrative data but you don't have the boundaries, this is a way of getting the boundaries in a spatial polygon. But so yes, I don't think that I need to mention that if you want to put different sources of data together, you need to know the coordinate reference systems. And the way in which are handled, this is by the DeepProc library, which I think is based on this collection of different types of coordinate reference system representation. So there is a way of converting from one to the other. So if you want to reproject data, there is a function which is called SP transform in the RGW package, which will help you to convert from example from longitudinal to UTM and some many other. So this is an example developed by Roger, where I think he transformed front and back the same point, and they compare it to the point, and I think the point moved. So I think this is just to show you that all these coordinate reference systems are good representation of the Earth, but you may get into trouble if you try to reproject the rock. So okay, so just to show you how to build vectors, there is function in preaching qualities in map tools, right? But this is not something that you want to use, because for example this will not read the coordinate reference system. The right way, in my opinion, is in the RGL package there is this read OGR. So this is a way in which you want to read a vector data. So vector data are essentially points, lines, and polygons. And if you can see here, this is in this case, this is the folder where we have the data. This is the name of the layer. In this case, this is a shape file, so this is the name of the file without the SHP. And you can see that, although I didn't mention the format here, this function, which is based on the OGR vector part of the GDAL library, recognizes it as a shape file and will load it, and it will also load the coordinate reference system. Okay, so this is something that you will not get if you use this quality. This is a previous function to this with OGR. I mean, it works, but this is the, I think this is And then I think attention formats that you can read from using this function. If you have Rasta data, you can also use the digital package. This is a list of the drivers for Rasta data that come with my with my installation of the GDAL library. And again, there is a simple way of logging this. Instead of Rico ER, I will use the GDAL. This is a GeoTIFF image. I think it's from the Boston, the Chicago, so the Chicago area. So this is an image that we loaded in R, and this is a special grid data frame. So we have a grid of pixels. Each pixel has a gray level, representing the color of the image, and that's the image. And of course there are, so this is the summary information that we get when we load this. So it created straight away a special grid data frame. So we don't need to worry about anything, just reading the data. And this is all the information, for example, about the projection and the grid used in this representation. And this is part one, is the gray level that we use with this image. Okay. And of course, we can use the write GDAL function and write OGR to write data. So essentially, we may get the raster data in the R. We can do some sort of statistical data analysis or filtering or anything, and then we want to get the results back into a raster image, so that we can use that right here. If we have vector data like boundaries, arbitrary boundaries, we do a regression analysis with estimates of income or anything, and then we want to create a zip file just to pass it on to our colleague. Just do it up with ArcGIS or any other software, then we can use this property. There are a number of GIS interfaces, but I'm going to skip this. So essentially, you can link to Quantum GIS, GRASS, and I think that also ArcGIS using Python, or I don't know, yeah, I think it's Python. And just the final example is about using Google Maps. So the GGMap package provides functions based on the ggplot package to have backgrounds as taken from Google Maps. So this is just the QMap function will get background. This is USA with this zoom level, and this is where I get the points from the tornado. So this is, okay. We can also use a density estimate just to find the peaks. So this is Kansas, is around here. You can see in this density estimate that here we have a peak in the concentration of tornadoes, right? It used to be possible to use an OpenStreetMap. So essentially, QMap is the function that will get you the background. You can choose the different sources. In this case, OpenStreetMap, but for some reason, the tile server that we use, I don't think it's available anymore. Okay, so this is essentially. But in the practical, you will see other types of, you can change the source into a statement, which is also another service or company providing background maps, and yeah, this is another way which you can use. In the spatial econometrics example, you will see how to produce similar map, but using boundaries and different colors for the administrative regions depending on the estimates of your. So this is all I wanted to mention about spatial data in R. So I think I know it's been quick, but now in the practical you will have time just to sit down and go through different examples. So in the practical, you will be able to work with geostatistical data, point patterns, and lattice data. So if you want to focus on lattice data, because that's the one that we will be focusing data, you can actually skip all the other data types. So you will have roughly an hour to do that, but that will be after the coffee break. So I think we will have a half an hour coffee break. So if you want a sticker or a pin, you can just come here and give one. Thank you. Yo sé dónde es aquí el cacho. So welcome back. So now we will have roughly 1 hour. So it's 11:15, so I'll give 12:15, then we can just start with the small lecture. So So in the folder practicals, you will find a zip file with all the information about the practicals. So if you unzip this file, you will find four practicals in PDF and they are associated with our files. And then you have three different data sets here. One is about the death per municipality in Spain, the other is about noise in Albacete, the place where I come from, and the other one is a point pattern of crime in San Francisco. So although I mentioned that we will be focusing on lattice data, but for this first practical, you will be working with essentially four types of data. The first one is this municipal death in Spain. This is taken from this newspaper, Cinco Días. So this is a data set that I have put together. I took the boundaries from the Spanish Institute for Statistics, and then I got this data about the municipal debt from this newspaper. So it was a bit difficult to put them together because we didn't have the municipal code here, so I had to use the name. But anyway, this is a very nice data set just to handle lattice data. The other one is the Columbus data sets, which is made of 49 neighborhoods in Columbus, Ohio, and there are information about crime, income, house value, and so on. So this is another example of lattice data. We will be using this data later to build model and to test for spatial correlation. Then there is a third data set is about crime in San Francisco. So this is taken from a website in San Francisco. I think it's the town hall website where they collect information about offenses in San Francisco. So this is a point pattern. And the last one is about noise in Albacete, which is taken from a report about noise released by the town hall. So they had the locations from the places where they measured noise for 24 hours. So so there is, you can actually check where noise is higher in Albacete, and this is a very interesting data set, and it's an example of the statistical. Okay. So because you have an hour, maybe you can start with the municipal debt and the Columbus data set, because these are the latest data. Or if you're interested in point patterns, you can check the crime data set in San Francisco, and then the noise in Albacete if you're interested in your statistical data. Okay, so here you have they are all in a separate file here. You have different steps just to load the data and visualize the data. So the idea is that you can go through all the steps and you can check the code and see how you can load different types of data. So the other thing here, in addition to having different types of data, is the format. The municipal depth in Spain is already provided in an R data file. So if you load this data, you will get this in a special document data frame. So there's nothing new to do. The Columbus dataset is an data set, so it's available through the data command. So you just write data Columbus and then you will get this. The crime in San Francisco is a point pattern. It's in a CSV file similar to the one that we were using for the tornadoes. And the last one, the noise in Albacete, is provided in different shape files. So in this graph, there are a couple of shape files, one with the boundary of the city, which is a special polygon, and the other one with the location of the measuring points, which is, I think, it's special points data. Okay, so you have different types of data in different formats. So I think this is good for you just to learn how to load different types of data in different formats. And here you have all the steps that you need to follow to load the data, visualize the data, and if you just want to make some maps, you will find also that. At the end, there is an example on how to use GGMap. I think it is prime in San Francisco to plot different types of points in with different backgrounds. So using GGMap, I think you can use Google Maps and the statement, but you can also try different sources. So you will have 1 hour, then we may have like a 5-10 minute break, and then we can resume with the second one. So yeah, if you have any questions, I will be around, so you can just raise your hand.
Incluso los que no tenemos acceso a la red, podemos bajarlo desde un acceso que no esté en la red interna.
¿Sin acceso a internet?
No, acceso a internet, pero no tengo acceso a la red interna.
¿Podemos mandar el enlace de Dropbox?
Sí, no, sí, de hecho, lo que es, si buscáis mi nombre en Google,
sí, hay un enlace. Yo he descargado de tu página, me he descargado el este almacén, pero es que no me coincide con los directorios que tenías.
Ah, bueno, igual, pero igual le has duplicado directorios con sello tocando. Sí, entonces, ahí en ese enlace tenéis todo el material.
Vale, vale, vale.
Igual, pero vamos a ver. Yo creo que igual lo reorganizáis un poco, pero está la parte de teoría en un directorio, luego en un fichero zip está toda la parte de los prácticos, y, pero si lo descomprimes es posible que te quede otro directorio adicional, pero está todo ahí.
Eso
es
lo que
estaba
explicando,
que yo creo que los prácticas han podido un directorio arriba para tener. Más o menos una hora, y luego paramos 5 o 10 minutos y luego ya seguimos con la segunda parte, que sería altura. Thank you.